I hope everyone's having a good night tonight. It's a lovely night out here at Copper Brick State Park. We have a great sunset going on. Not the worst job in the world. It should be a good night for some moon view. Getting a phone call. There we go. You know, with anything on Zoom, there always has to be some sort of technical hiccup. Yeah. And, you know, phone calls, it can't be helped, unfortunately.
That may or may not happen again with that particular phone.
Looks like we have a great crowd starting up. We're going to give people a few more minutes or a minute or two to trickle in, and then we'll get started with our programming. Yeah, we're really excited to have you out here tonight. We've really lucked out weather-wise. Clouds are looking wispy, but nothing that's going to obstruct our view bad enough to not see the moon. And it's not 20 degrees. It's not miserably cold. It should be an excellent night to spend outdoors. Try to get that sunset in view again. It's, you know, it's worth seeing. Now, we're not completely roughing it out here. We are right next to our headquarters building. You can see our Ethernet cable running to give us our internet. But we don't have to retreat in there for warmth, luckily, and should be all right. 95 people in here. That's exciting. I hope everybody's doing all right. I hope it's as nice where you are, wherever you are in the world, as it is here in Quanah. The number of people hasn't gone down yet, which is a good start. I don't know if y'all can hear that, but we've got some coyotes joining us for the program tonight. They're excited that the moon's out. It's one of my favorite parts of Copper Breaks is having a little serenade. They sound wild on my end. I don't know if they come through the speakers, but.
Looks like we might have a couple people with some audio issues. I'd say give them a little bit longer.
You guys hear me all right?
I got a couple in here say, I hear them. Hi, Rangers Stewart. Yep, we can hear them. I think we're good.
It looks like our numbers are tapering off, so we're going to get started here. As y'all can see from my name tag, I am Ranger Stewart. I'm the interpreter out here at Copper Breaks. I always tell folks I have the fun job of getting to do all the programs, besides some of Will's. Ranger Will here, he's the superintendent here at Copper Break State Park. He's been doing astronomy programs longer than I am. And we're really excited to get this live from outside, Marvel at the Moon at Copper Breaks going. It's kind of unique and new event for both of us. And we're hoping that this is a format we can continue in the future and hope y'all like it. I like to start this program out by asking if any of you have ever been to Copper Breaks. We're gonna post a Q&A. Have you ever been to Copper Break State Park? We are not the most visited. I want to get an idea of how many of y'all have been here before. We're not going to grade you. Give people a few more seconds to respond so we can get a little bit of a sample size. All right, I think that's enough time. Let's look at our results.
We got
about 60-40.
60-70.
I have heard of Copper Breaks. 60% have heard of Copper Breaks, and 92% have not been here before. Well, that's okay. I won't hold it against you. I'm just excited that you want to learn about our park. We love this place, and we hope that you love it too after tonight. But 60% have heard of it. I would bet. And we're not going to ask a question about this, but I would bet a lot of you have heard about us for our dark skies. It's one of our most, probably our most famous assets that we have here at Copper Breaks, and they are excellent. But we have a lot to offer, and I want to talk about our park for a little bit so you can see what we're about before we really dive into the lunar program. So for context, and I use DFW as a reference point, since most of our visitors are campers from the Dallas area, we are about 3 hours to the northwest of Fort Worth. Tack on an extra 45 minutes for farther east in DFW. For closer folks from Wichita Falls, we're about an hour and a half in the same direction. And we are the closest international dark sky park to the Metroplex. Copper Breaks has more than dark skies, though. As you might guess from the name, there is copper here, although not mineable amounts, at least not anymore. Historically, there was. That bit on the left is a piece of malachite, which is copper ore that we find all over the place here. But besides the copper, we have all sorts of wonderful geology, red rock, badland country that spans the north shore of the Pease River out here south of Quanah, and it really can be quite beautiful. Besides minerals, we have all sorts of wildlife and symbols of the state of Texas. Copper Breaks is really lucky to have 9 members of the state of Texas longhorn herd. And I always like to tell folks, we've got the hungriest, maybe friendliest longhorns in the state of Texas. They love to be fed by visitors. And we do that longhorn program twice a week, every week that the park is open. And it is always a good time. The horned toad on the right, of course, one of my favorite reptiles. And we have quite a few of them, especially in the summertime. We have a good amount of harvester ants. We see them a lot. And then besides the wildlife and besides the geology, we just have beautiful views. This is open sky country. That's one reason it's good for night skies. It's all right for sunsets too. I mean, we're taking this live. Sunsets are always great out here as long as it's not overcast. We do get cold up here in the northern part of the state, and we get some snow. I took that picture the other day. That's on our Juniper Ridge Trail. We had a nice dusting of snow. We still have a little bit out there. And then, of course, I have a sunset photo over the Pease River, but I almost didn't need to put that one on there because we have such a nice sunset tonight. But yes, the big sky and wide open spaces are what make Copper Breaks really special. So, another reason, as I mentioned earlier on our map, Copper Breaks is an international dark sky park. Well, what does that even mean? Well, first thing is, well, kind of obviously, it's dark. And it is really dark. We'll talk about dark sky ratings and light pollution later in the program, but it is obviously pretty dark out here, especially when it's a new moon. We have to follow guidelines set by the International Dark Sky Association to keep night sky friendly lighting. Essentially, that means our lighting is recessed in a way that does not interfere with viewing at night. And I'll show you some examples in a minute. And then, of course, we have to do night sky programming as well to keep that designation, like we're doing right now. We do all sorts of programs out here, and we're planning on expanding it even more. I do night hikes, which are not necessarily star-based, but since we're an international dark sky park, it's pretty hard to ignore how good the sky is here at Copper Breaks, even if I'm talking about critters at night. Will, our superintendent, does storytelling, which is a cultural storytelling program, which we're going to do a little bit of later in regards to the moon. And then we're actually going to continue our Star Walk program, which is kind of our flagship astronomy program. That's how I'd describe it. It's a telescope-based program where volunteers come in, bring their rigs, and we explore the sky with y'all. I have that scheduled on our website. Shameless plug, I know. Now on the screen, we got a picture of our headquarters. That's the great museum and headquarters of Copper Breaks State Park, which you also see behind me here, except we're looking at the garage. Not very glamorous, I know. That is Copper Breaks headquarters during the day. We have a couple of lights out front. And during the night, you can see our lights all face downward. We don't have any exposed bulbs that are pointing straight up and contributing to light pollution in the area. So that is part of the International Dark Sky Association Dark Sky Park requirement, is to make sure that our lights are at a certain angle, that are covered, and that they aren't obstructing viewing at all. And we're at, like, what, 99% compliance? We're at almost 100% compliance with our lighting, and it really makes a difference. Our campgrounds are pretty dark, but the viewing is good. Oh, my gimbal. Excuse me, I haven't used a gimbal in a long time, so I pressed a button.
All right.
So, I said it was dark. Well, how dark? Well, there's a scale that we often use in TPWD and that astronomers will sometimes use called the Bortle scale. Copper bricks is a 2 on the Bortle scale, and I'll explain how dark that is in a second. What does that mean? Well, the Bortle scale is a scale of how dark the sky is, using light meters to determine how much light pollution there is, as well as what objects are even visible at all in the night sky. So it takes those factors into account. You can figure out what we are. So we are a 2. If you look at that chart, it's quite dark. A 1 would be the middle of Big Bend National Park in the middle of the Chihuahuan Desert. That's a 1. 9 would be the middle of Dallas with all the lights turned on. It's not very good and don't see very much. So copper breaks is quite good, especially for its proximity to some sort of urban areas. We're not really close, but we're not way out in the desert either. So we're really fortunate that we have this pocket of good night skies here south of Kwana. And of course, this is a picture taken by an amateur photographer out at our Comanche campground. If you've been here before, all 8% of you, you can see the Comanche campground teepee shelters that we have with a wonderful long exposure Milky Way above them. So I know I just talked about dark skies and showed a big picture of the Milky Way. Why are we looking at the moon, Ranger Stewart? What's so cool about the moon? You've got way more to offer. Well, there's a couple of practical reasons. But first of all, the moon's awesome. And we're going to look at it in some extreme detail tonight. And I think you'll all appreciate it. The moon is an awesome place. It's the only world we've ever set foot on besides our own. And there are so many different geologic features, cultural associations with different cultures all around the world. And it is just a joy to look at in extreme detail. Let's talk about how we're going to observe the moon a little bit. There's a couple of misconceptions about the moon in general. We like to call them moon myths. One of those is that there's a dark side of the moon. There's not. There's not a dark side of the moon. The moon actually does rotate in orbit. However, we see one face of it because it is tidally locked. It's one face always points at Earth. What happens though, as the Earth rotates, the moon is looking at us, and of course, different sides of the moon are exposed to the sun as the moon orbits the Earth and as we spin. Now, that can be kind of confusing. We actually have a program where we demonstrate that with styrofoam balls on sticks, and you hold them out and walk around a lamp. You can get an idea of what's actually happening. Though the moon is constantly looking at Earth, it is getting sun on all its sides. And the moon circles the Earth on around its roughly 27-day period, which is very close to a month, which is why when we have moon phases, we get all of them in a month. Although there's some like deviations, since it's 27 days, it's not exactly a month. Where we are right now is the first quarter. So how many days would you say that's been since the new moon, Will?
It's about 10.
A little under 10.
10, 12.
So the first quarter is really good for viewing the moon. And you might say, hey, the full moon would be better, right? Because then you can see all of it. Well, I like to compare it to the landscape at Copper Breaks. For those of you who have been here, we have a bunch of small canyons and ridges that often look way sharper when there's long shadows, right? The dark line in the middle of the first quarter is called the terminator. It's where the shadow and the light meet. That area especially, but even pretty far away from the terminator, can lead to some really long shadows that make those features on the moon pop quite a bit more, and it makes it for some really spectacular viewing. Let's talk about our optics that we've got. So currently we have what's called a reflector telescope. Ours is a Dobsonian reflector telescope, but all reflector telescopes work on the same principle. They have a big hole in the front and a big mirror in the back, and a lot of light is let in, and that light is what we need to see. So bigger the bowl, essentially, of the mirror in the back, the more light you can collect, and ideally more detail and higher resolution you can get. What you'll notice, and I'm not doing this just as an excuse, but what you'll notice is that things will seem different. I'm going to show you a map of the lunar surface here after this slide than what you see when we're actually showing you on camera. That's because the mirror actually flips the image and it will be upside down. So we have to navigate kind of upside down, and it's awkward. So if it takes us a moment to get on an object before we talk about it, just bear with us, because it's a little counterintuitive sometimes, but it's fun to try. So this is a very nice map from NASA. is actually posted for a lunar event years ago, but it's convenient because it shows what the moon looks like at first quarter, like it looks right now. Of course, again, it will be flipped. So the bright side will be on the left when we're looking at it in the telescope on screen. But in real life, the light side is on the right side. And you can see some of the features we're going to try to look at with our scope, including mountains, seas, which I'll explain in a little bit when you get to look at one, and then quite a few craters. So, Will, unless there's anything you want to add, we're going to get looking at the feed on the telescope. Let's get it.
All right. Y'all should be looking at what our telescope is looking at, which is nothing right now.
We have to refocus the telescope on it. So currently, since we started the program so early, usually you align the telescope with a series of stars. Well, the stars weren't out enough for us to line the telescope up yet. So we're manually, we're shooting in the dark, even though it's not that dark yet. And it will take just a few seconds to get back on the moon. I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a second. So I'm going to try to line up our scope. Go up a little bit. Up. Okay, stop. Go right. So what we're doing right now trying to look through the eyepiece to get the moon in frame. Once we do that, we should be good to go. Stop. Go down a little bit. One. All right. Go, stop. Go right. Stop. Down. Up, other down. Stop. You should be able to find it now. So, as I was saying, can actually see the moon in frame now. And you'll notice we got quite a bit more detail than just looking at it, even with a pair of binoculars. And you can see some incredible definition on the surface. So that was just kind of our eyeballing it to get on target. Ranger Will can actually move and pan the camera around. Not really the camera, actually the telescope. The camera's attached to the eyepiece of the telescope. And we can look at different objects on the lunar surface. So there are a few things to point out at first. First of all, the incredible detail. Second of all, it's not very plain, is it? There's all sorts of bumps and flat areas and holes and all sorts of other features that give the moon quite a bit of character. And there's a couple of terms I want to talk to you about and a couple of features I want to go over. So, Will, if you could show us one of the seas. Yes, the moon has seas, although they don't have any water. It's kind of a confusing term. It comes from the word sea in Latin, and they're called mare. Mare is actually the singular. Maria is the plural for it. But there are these big dark spots. They're pretty obvious even with the naked eye, right? But in frame, they are huge, right? The mare are flat plains of basalt that formed pretty early in the moon's life cycle when large meteors hit the moon and those filled up with lava. Basalt's often associated with lava on Earth as well. It's that black rock that you'll see in Hawaii that's on the shore in some places, or that hexagonal rock you'll see. Have you ever seen that in Ireland? That's basalt as well, although this is not the same kind. But it is essentially fill from the mantle, the liquid inside of the moon, filling back up after a huge impact. These maria, these seas, are pretty large. I want to talk about scale for a second here, actually, before we talk about the maria themselves. So when you look at the moon in the sky, it's, you know, obviously the biggest, brightest object in the sky. When it comes to size, the diameter of it is roughly about the size of Australia in relation to Earth, to give you a little bit of perspective of scale, right? But some of the objects on it are huge as well. The Sea of Tranquility, or I don't even know how to say, Mare Tranquillitatis, is where the Apollo 11 mission landed. That sea is about 450 miles wide. So these are huge features of relatively flat, smooth area compared to other parts of the lunar surface. But yeah, no, the moon is a really large object circling our planet compared to other moons and other planet systems. Proportionally, our moon is huge compared to the size of our planet. For comparison, Mars's moons, as two moons, are extremely small compared to ours. So you can see one of those seas right there. Huge, relatively featureless, dark area of basalt that filled in from that traumatic early life of the moon. Do you think you can find us the Sea of Tranquility?
Probably not. There's another sea.
So can you go back to the PowerPoint and show the map? Mm-hmm. I'll show this on the map and then we can see if we can find it in the in panning around. If we can't, it's not like we'll be able to see Apollo from here, but if you look, okay.
That might have been where we were.
So we might be in the Sea of Tranquility where we are right now. So in the southern part, kind of the southwestern part of the Sea of Tranquility, it's where Apollo 11 landed. You can see that 11 on that diagram, on that map. So Will's going to try to get to it. Just remember, everything's upside down. So sometimes it's a little bit difficult to get things oriented, right?
Yep. So that is the
Sea of so that's the bottom of the Sea of Tranquility. So
this spot right here is the Sea of Tranquility.
I don't know if you heard Will say that. That dark spot, the larger one on top, he's going to move his cursor around it again. That's the Sea of Tranquility. So near the top of it, which is actually the bottom, which is the southern end of it on the moon, again, flipped, is where Apollo 11 landed back in 1969. Pretty cool to get as close as we can to it. I'm going to shut my camera off because I don't think I can even be seen anymore.
Okay, it's dark. I can't see.
It's too dark to see anyway, so you don't need to look at the silhouette of my head. So we talked about the seas, which are very huge remnants of impacts that filled back in with lava a long, long time ago. But there's also a bunch of craters on the moon, right? Obviously, they're one of the most defining features. Recent studies have shown that there could be as many as 100,000 craters on the moon, which is an incredibly high number. But after looking at it in this much detail, I have no doubt that that's true. There can be extremely small craters in the regolith, the surface of the moon, the substrate, the material on the surface of the moon. And there can be giant craters on the moon. There's a couple of different types. There's really two main types. There are simple and complex. We've got an example of two right here, which are really good. We've got simple, which are from smaller impacts. You can see that like ridge on the outside of it. It's a lighter color. That lifted rims from the impact, right? The regolith was uplifted and settled on the top, creating these pretty high peaks and a shallow bowl. I'll show you a diagram of a cross section of one in a minute, but we'll look at these. They're too cool to look at in person instead of looking at a diagram, but I'll show you on that the differences. To the right, you'll see a large crater. It's quite a bit bigger than our simple crater and it has this weird bump in the middle. That's called a complex crater. Really all that means is that the impact was larger, it was stronger. And it created a more complex feature, a feature that has a little bit more character. That middle part is called the central uplift. Essentially all that's from is that when the meteor hit so hard, the shock from back in the moon shot back out and lifted this huge mound of material in the center. There also isn't that much of a raised rim compared to our simple crater. That's mostly because when a meteorite hits the moon or any planet or moon extremely hard, like the forces that create a complex crater, that wall, that raised rim, is actually too tall to support itself and it usually collapses. And you'll see, you can kind of see it if you use your imagination on this screen, that there's actually kind of a terraced effect. It falls down kind of like a rice terrace or something like that, where it's actually like a stairway as it collapses into the crater. Now I mentioned scale earlier and how the Sea of Tranquility is about 450 miles wide, give or take. And the moon's about as wide as Australia. If you were to look, you know, lay it flat on the earth. So this crater, the one with the central uplift, the complex crater, that one that Will has the cursor over is named Theophilus. Most of these craters have names, except for the really small ones. That crater, for perspective, is about 62 miles wide and a little over a mile and a half deep. So it is a large feature that makes up a huge portion of the landscape on the moon. So imagine that at 62 miles wide, which it's incredible that it's still that small when we're this zoomed in. So Will, if you don't mind showing them the cross section of the simple and complex crater, unless you want to add something.
Go back to PowerPoint.
Yeah, go back to PowerPoint and go forward to the crater. There we go. So there's a picture of two craters. You're still sharing the moon.
Yes, I am.
That's all right. There we go. So now you're looking back at our PowerPoint. There's two examples of craters. So you can see that simple crater, right? It's got that raised rim and it's pretty defined. That's actually a picture from a crater on Mars, but same effect, right? And then on the right, we have that complex crater. You see those ridges falling down into it? It's that terrace, almost looks like a quarry that someone's dug out. And then that central uplift in the middle. You can see those cross sections. You can see the difference in how the rim is higher in the simple crater and lower in the complex crater. Although the complex craters are usually considerably bigger, you can see that scale of 1 kilometer on the left on the simple crater and 10 kilometers on the complex crater. It's kind of cool that we can use these diagrams, but also see them in real time back on the moon. So how about we try to go look at the mountain range? So the moon has mountains. A lot of times they're on the edge of the seas or craters where there is some serious uplift. One of the coolest and should be visible tonight is the Apennine Mountains, which are actually named after a mountain range on Earth. They run through central Italy, but they've also got Apennine Mountains on the moon. There they are. See those big bumps in the bottom of the moon? Will can adjust the contrast and we can actually get some definition. This is why you do it on a first quarter. You can actually see the shadows of the mountains on the moon. Those mountains, they're not small. I'll say that. They range in height about 6,000 feet to about 16,000 feet. So a little higher than our Rocky Mountains out west in Colorado. They are imposing mountains, to say the least. Now, Apollo 15 actually landed at the base of the Apennine Mountains. And I highly recommend, if you want to get the chance, to look at some of the Apollo 15 photos from it, because you can actually see the astronauts with the moon buggy and the mountains in the background. It's a pretty incredible sight to see a mountain range on a different world. That turns out real good.
Yes, it does. I'm going to try to find some ejecta.
Yeah, Will's going to go back to craters and show us another feature of craters, especially really large ones. There's a fun little anecdote, a fun little story. Back at the turn of the century, scientists were still learning about stuff at the moon. We still are, right? They didn't know the origins of these craters. Like, where did these come from? Did they come from volcanoes or did they come from meteors? And it wasn't until after aerial photography in World War I where they kind of got a better idea of, a projectile hitting the ground hard enough actually like creates these features. They were able to see some of it. So yeah, you can see that kind of lighter coloration coming off of that crater that Ranger Will is pointing out with his cursor. That's called ejecta. Really, it's just matter from the projectile and matter from the ground that is being shot everywhere. We're pretty serious impact. And there are some craters with many, 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 many miles of ejecta on the moon that can be really sharp. Unfortunately, where the moon's at today, there aren't huge ones like Tycho Crater, which takes up a huge portion of the bottom of the moon. When you're looking at it with the naked eye, there's a good example. Those light streaks coming from that crater, yeah, you can see how it really pops. So I was talking about the scale of the seas. Those, I have to guess that those those ejecta lines, they have to be what, 100 miles? That'd be my guess based, and that's a complete, you know, eyeball, but definitely dozens of miles of just material from major impacts, which really stand out quite a bit when you have a scope like this. I mean, kind of zoom in on it, and there might even be some farther down off screen. It's hard to tell sometimes, like, how far they go. You can see that the ejecta are on top of the mare there. Obviously, the crater impact happened after to deposit on there. Now, there are all sorts of features. You can even see on the horizon of the moon how it's not perfectly round. You can see some of those features. There's no atmosphere on the moon to distort this stuff, and unless our atmosphere is distorted, but there's no real clouds above us right now, just some wispy ones. You can see how the edge of the moon isn't perfectly spherical. It's got a little bit of a character, a little roughness. Man, that looks good.
It does. I'm going to come over here. There's a bunch of craters towards this side.
And this is another reason why you do it when there's shadows, because those craters near the Terminator, you can really get a sense of depth on them. The crater I pointed out earlier, of course, over a mile deep. No doubt that some of these are that deep as well, although I don't know the depth of every crater, but you can see where people might have thought it was made of cheese looking.
Right.
Looking at it. Of course, the moon isn't this green outside right now. That's the nature of our camera. So it looks even more cheese-like with the green, but the just the sheer texture when you have this kind of scope and this really quite perfect conditions for lighting. Get an idea how deep these craters are just by looking at it. And you don't get that when it's a full moon. So we're just a little enamored, if you don't mind us looking, just enjoying how it looks.
Not every day you get to look at the craters on the moon this close.
Not without being an Apollo astronaut. And yeah, being able to adjust that brightness, you can really get some features to pop. You need me to adjust the focus at all?
If you want it more.
Let me know if it gets too blurry.
Is it getting blurrier?
I can kind of see it in my eye. That looks a little better.
It does look a little better.
We'll keep it there. I don't want to mess with it too much and make the viewing worse. But now with our telescope, we have an electronic control, which allows us to have some fine movement and be able to pan over these features. If any of you have ever used telescopes before and have tried to do things manually, I'm sure you understand how difficult it can be to stay on a target. So as Earth is rotating, the moon is obviously moving, right? So Will's not doing anything right now. This is just the moon. The moon's not moving. We're moving, right? As we spin, the moon is moving out of frame. If we were to have this scope pointing at Jupiter or Saturn right now, which they're not out currently, I think technically Jupiter is, but it's behind a cloud, it would only be in frame, what, a few seconds? It doesn't take very long for it to get out of frame. So
yes, I'm not touching the controls at all. This is just the movement of the Earth right now. Whenever I start going in the opposite direction, that's me controlling the camera.
We can adjust speeds on the camera so we can pan fast and slow. It allows us to get shots without needing tracking, which again would have been too hard tonight considering the circumstances. So if you look at the moon, I don't know, depending on where you are, depending on what the weather is like, if you look at the moon on any given night, those seas, the Maria, they produce images. Well, at least people in the past have seen images in them. The most famous, of course, is the man in the moon. With our zoom that we currently see, I don't see a whole lot of unique images, but our brains like to create patterns, right? They like to find images in things like clouds, in toast, in all sorts of different objects, and the moon is no exception. And it's been a part of human lives forever, right? And so whenever you're ready, we'll go to the PowerPoint and show some of those examples of, I like this slide, I'll show y'all. I think it's fun. Well, we didn't get to talk about this yet. We can go back and talk about it later, but it's also interesting. But there are, of course, infinite amount of things you can see in the moon. There's a couple examples here. There's the man in the moon. Now, when I think of the man in the moon, I think of a face. I really like the second from the right. That's what I see when I think of the man in the moon. He doesn't look as detailed as the one left of him, but some people have seen full bodies of men, women in the moon, and I also like the second from the left, the rabbit in the moon. At least I think that's a rabbit. Strange looking, but again, these patterns come to us when we look at celestial objects, and they're inspiration for a lot of stories. And Ranger Will is now going to give us a tale from Native American folklore.
All right. This is Ranger Will here. When we look up at the sky, or we look at the moon, or we look at stars, or we look at the clouds, we tend to, like Ranger Stewart said, see images and pictures. We connect the dots, we draw patterns, and it's just part of our brain's hardwiring. We do that naturally. And before we had fancy telescopes and all sorts of modern equipment to measure distances and explain the world scientifically, we had to tell it in our own way, with our brains, our fancy human brains that like to make the most awesome and dramatic tales and stories. And the moon is no different. There are many, many moon stories. It has been with us just like the sun since humanity first opened its eyes and started walking across the face of the earth. So it's only natural that we would have a number of different star stories of our own. The one that I'm going to tell you tonight is a Native American story about the moon, and it is regarding the moon phases and how the moon phases work and how that it was explained in this particular story. And before I tell it, I want to go ahead and give a little bit of a disclaimer. This is my memorization and my retelling of a story. I'm going to miss some details. I'm going to mess it up a little bit if it's your favorite story. But that's just how storytelling works, right? It's an oral tradition. These stories get passed down from generation to generation. It's like a game of telephone. Details change, names change. And the important thing is that the bulk of the story, the point, the theme that's trying to get across, the tale that is being told is the same. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with that now. A long time ago, there were two cousins who were as close as sisters. They did everything together. They spent all of their time together. They were best friends. Like I said, they were as close as sisters. They might as well have been sisters. And they were coming of the age where the people of the tribe expected them to marry. And they begin to wonder who they would choose to marry, who would win their hearts. But the thing was, none of the men in the tribe appealed to the two cousins because they were in love with the moon. They would go sit by the beach with their feet in the sand, look up at the sky and talk and just watch the moon as it went across the sky. They would talk to each other and say, look how handsome the moon is walking across the heavens. I wish I could marry the moon. Wouldn't that be great? And they did that quite frequently. They would go out and they would talk about the moon, and everybody was still wondering, who are they going to marry? And one day when they were sitting beside the beach looking at the moon, it suddenly dipped behind the trees and it got dark. They heard footsteps in the sand, and a man walked up to them who had a bright, shining, glowing mask on his face. And he said to the girls, I am the moon. I've heard you talking, and I have decided I'm in need of a wife, and I will marry one of you. Now, one of the cousins said, but we've never been apart. We've always been together. You need to marry both of us. So the moon said, okay, that works. And he agreed. But it was on a condition. You have to come up to the land in the sky with me. And on this journey, you must keep your eyes closed and not open your eyes. They agreed. And he grabbed them. They closed their eyes. And he continued his march across the sky. And for a while, both of the sisters kept their eyes closed. Or the sisters, the cousins, their closest sisters, kept their eyes closed. But after a little bit, one of them grew impatient and opened just one eye just a little bit. And as she did that, she fell down to the earth and she landed on the beach right where she had left, unharmed. But she no longer got to go into the sky. The other cousin kept her eyes squeezed tight until they got up into the land of the sky. When they got there, they were married. My home is now yours, said the moon. You can do anything you like up here, but the only thing I ask is that you do not go into the room next to ours. You do not even lift the blanket that is covering the door. And she agreed. And for a while, she was very happy. The moon was a very kind and loving husband, but he had kind of an erratic work schedule. She didn't know when he was going to leave, and he'd be gone for long periods of time. And there were no humans up in the land of the sky. It was just her, and she had no one to talk to beside the husband. So she began to get a little lonely and bored. And so one day she complained to the moon. She said, well, why can't I go with you? I could help you carry the light across the sky. And then moon said, well, this is just how it has to be. You're a human, and you won't be able to carry the light of the moon across the sky. It'll be too heavy. And that was that. So she continued along her day. It had been multiple days since she had seen her husband, and she began to get bored. So she decided that she was going to go walk around outside, and she started going down a trail. And towards the end of this trail, she saw a person that was staring into a hole in the ground. She got really excited because this is the first person she's seen in months. And she ran over and she started talking and getting really excited. And as she was talking, the person did not respond to her. She was being ignored. And so she said, okay, that's kind of strange. And she just kept on walking, and she ran into more people like that. People that were sitting on the ground, looking into a hole in the ground, not looking at her, ignoring her as she was speaking. And eventually she grew irritated. And so the next person that she came across staring at a hole in the ground, she started talking, and she was being ignored once more. And so she started to kick him with her foot. The person got annoyed, lifted their head up, and said, stop bothering me, I'm working. And as he did that, she noticed that there was a great glowing eye in the center of the forehead. This unnerved her a little bit, so she ran as fast as she could back to the house. Once she got to the house, she decided she wanted to know what it was like to carry the weight of the light of the moon across the sky. So she opened the blanket that was covering the door into the forbidden room. And when she looked in, she saw on the wall a series of masks ranging from just barely the sliver of a new moon to a quarter moon to a three-quarter moon, all the way to the great glowing bright mask of the full moon. She walked up and grabbed the mask of the first quarter and placed it upon her face, and it got stuck. She couldn't remove it. She tried and she tried to pull it off of her face, but she just couldn't do it. And she panicked because at that moment she heard the moon getting home. So she ran really fast to the bed and covered her face with a blanket. When the moon saw her sitting there with her face covered, he was concerned. He asked, "Are you okay? Are you feeling all right? Are you sick?" And she said, "My face hurts. I'm in a little bit of face pain. I'm all good though." And he came over and he went to check on her. And as he picked up the blanket, he just started laughing. He laughed and he laughed and he laughed. And he reached down and he gently removed the moon mask from her face. And he said, "I think you should tell me what else you've been doing going on today. What else have you been up to today?" And so she told him the story of walking down the trail and seeing the scary people with great glowing eyeballs on their foreheads. And he said, "Those are the stars. Do not bother them while they're working. But I can tell," said the moon, "that I have misjudged you. It is clear that you have the strength to carry the moon phases with me. And so from here on out, you will accompany me on my journey across the sky. I will carry the full moon to the last quarter, and you will carry the new moon to the first quarter, and we will walk the sky together." And so that's how it has been since. The moon and his wife walk across the sky every evening with a different mask upon their face, with a different amount of light showing. Now, there are a lot of different star stories. There are a lot of different moon stories. That's the one that I've chosen to tell tonight because it was relevant to the moon. But a common theme that you'll see amongst particularly the Native American stories that I have read, that I've listened to, is that they tend to explain the world. They tend to provide an explanation for the natural world, and they provide a connection between people and the world around them. And that is one thing that stories do really well. They allow us an outlet to connect with the world outside. And a really important part about that is being outside, going outside, having the opportunity to connect with the world. One thing I like to tell people after I do programs for stars and constellations is it doesn't matter if you can't see the man in the moon. It doesn't matter if you can't see Hercules or the Big Dipper. It doesn't matter. Make your own constellation. Go out there, connect the dots yourself, tell your own star stories. The important part is getting outside and seeing these things, seeing these natural wonders that we have available to us that we honestly don't take enough advantage of. I know I don't, and I have the opportunity to more than most. And I have to remind myself to take those opportunities. And I challenge you all to get outside, go look at the moon. You don't have to be in a dark sky park to look at the moon. You can see the moon from everywhere. And you don't have to have a big old telescope like we got right now to look at the moon. It's fun looking at the moon with your naked eye. It's fun looking at the moon through a pair of binoculars. Anything you have is good enough. The important part is getting outside. Stuart?
Yeah, I'll take that. Will, if you don't mind scrolling around, you're probably going to do a better job at it than I am. Folks, thank you for bearing with me trying to navigate around the moon as well as I could. I got it on target at least. So, really like your story, Will. Kind of reminds me, I do night hikes out here, as I mentioned earlier, trying not to take advantage of the fact that we live in this awesome place. And on my night hikes, I'll often be looking for scorpions and other critters, and not even realize that the Milky Way is out. And then I look up after I stop blabbering on for a while. I'm like, oh my gosh, that is incredible. And then while I'm looking up, I walk into a prickly pear, which is usually the nature of my night hikes, but it's extremely rewarding. And we're so glad you joined us tonight. Now, a lot of you have asked questions in our Q&A, and you're more than welcome to ask us questions. I'll try to get to as many as I can. But I've got a few that I was looking at. I'm going to answer them live over here. But there's a couple that Will are going to have to answer because they're about these stories. And there are some wonderful Native American stories, especially about the stars and constellations. So Cynthia asked, do you know if this is where Apollo 11 aimed to land or if they just ended up landing there? I looked into this earlier today. The Sea of Tranquility was their original location for their landing site. But they were worried about what the terrain of the moon would be like, what the surface level would be like, and they understood that there might be like some room for error. So they gave themselves a few miles. They weren't down to the inch with where they're planning on aiming. But yes, they figured the Sea of Tranquility would be a good spot to land. And I have to imagine that has to do with a different question from a different Cynthia. Asking, are the craters scattered all over the moon or are they heavier in some areas? So they're definitely heavier in some areas. If you look even through our scope tonight, you can see that the lunar seas have a lower density. That's because that area of the moon was resurfaced. And it was a long time ago, but a lot of these craters were from quite a bit before. And then when that got resurfaced by the molten rock that kind of filled in the gaps with basalt, there are quite a few less craters on those seas. And I have to imagine that's partially why the first moon landing, they said, yeah, we should probably do this on a flat area with not too many potholes. That way we don't risk it on our first try. But as I said, with Apollo 15, they changed it up a little bit and went to the foothills of the Apennine Mountains to get different data. David, we're sorry, your wife and daughter missed it. This will be recorded. So I don't know if that'll be available for people to watch in the future, but we'll try to keep you posted on that. The lighter areas, just higher ground, Tiff asked. Yes, lighter areas are the higher ground. So we don't think of sea level on the moon in the same sense as Earth. We kind of do. The seas are the lowest plains on the moon. And so when I mentioned that the Apennine Mountains were such high, 6,000 feet to 16,000 feet high, that's above lunar sea level. That's above the level of those dark planes on the moon. And so, yeah, the lighter areas are often sometimes dramatically higher ground, like those mountain ranges. Appreciate you guys chiming in. Yeah, it was a great story. Oh, you got to hear the coyotes? That's great to hear. I'm
glad y'all could hear it. I didn't think it'd come through the phone.
Yeah, I wasn't sure either. So iPhone's got a good mic, I guess. Is there anything that humans can do to take care of the moon and not cause damage like we've already done to Earth from Jenna? Well, we haven't spent as much time on the moon, which is a good thing. But, you know, there are things to consider with not just the moon, but with space travel in general. There's definitely a lot of space junk orbiting Earth, which could be a problem for future satellites, for future telescopes. And for our travel into space, and we definitely leave a lot behind when we do these missions. And if you've ever seen the Apollo missions, you see, we did leave landing gear on the moon when we left. We left the buggy. We didn't drive it back. Didn't have enough fuel to bring it back. We left that stuff out there. Luckily, potentially, the moon doesn't have any life. So we're not going to introduce a new invasive species or something. But believe it or not, on different worlds around the solar system where there are questions of whether there's life, like the moon of Titan around Saturn, like the moon of Enceladus around Saturn, like the moon of Europa around Jupiter, scientists now with the understanding that there is a possibility potentially for life on one of those moons, they take cautions. The Cassini space probe is a good example. They crashed that into Saturn where it's almost certainly lifeless to ensure that nothing from Cassini could ever get to any of those moons and potentially spread something, even though it had been in space for 20 years. So I think the scientists at NASA and the European Space Agency are doing a good job ensuring that we try not to pollute too many other worlds, but that is a very good point. But Will, what was the title of your story, Thomas is asking?
The title of that story, I actually didn't, I've always just called it my moon phase myth. It doesn't have an actual title. That particular story and a couple others that I generally tell come from a program called Sky Tellers from the Lunar Planetary Institute. They have a great staff there that has members of different native groups, and they have combined their different stories into one big program that they share with different aspects of the night sky. So there's a bunch of moon myths, there's star stories, there's galaxy stuff, there's universe creation stuff. So there's a bunch of different stuff, and you can find a whole lot of different resources online for moon stories. I don't have any specific names of books that you can find, but there are some out there. And actually there is a computer application called Stellarium that has a lot of different myths
from all over the world
in it, in its digital library. So if you're looking at a particular planet or a particular constellation, you can use that software to also look at the different myths.
It's free too, which doesn't hurt. We had someone ask about a book. We got one in our library somewhere about Native American constellations, but I don't have one off the top of my head either. I apologize. But if you look up online, you pretty quickly find some of the more popular and more reputable story books about, some are just generally about Native American myths in general, but a lot of the general ones.
Keeper.
All right, that's one. Yeah, I remember we were looking at one earlier in our library. Thank you. Appreciate it. So how many seas does the moon have? Emily asks. Well, they have 20 major seas are on the moon. And most of them are on our side, don't want to say light side. Remember, it's not the light side of the moon, but on the earth facing side of the moon, the majority, there's a couple on the far side as well, but there are 20 major ones. Karen asked, very cool. Do you think it's possible to build a human base camp on the moon? There has been, I know NASA's looked into it. There have been studies to see, like, is there even water on the moon? When it comes to space travel, every pound, every ounce, every gram, the lightest amount of weight makes a huge difference of getting it off of Earth and out of Earth's gravity. So if you have to carry water, if you've ever been hiking with a bunch of water on your back or backpacking in the desert or even here at Copper Breaks where it's quite dry, water's heavy. It's not light whatsoever. And it's heavy for spacecraft as well. So is there water on the moon? Well, in some minerals, there are, I know they found water on the moon subsurface in the form of ice, but I think it's pretty poorly distributed. It's not like there's big springs of it pouring out, but it's in the soil, it's in the regolith. But you'd have to look into that a little bit more. I don't have an amount per like square foot or per square mile, but there is some. And with that, I know they're talking about, well, it's another thing humans need. We don't just need water, we also need air. The moon doesn't have any oxygen, has no atmosphere. We got to breathe something. And if we're going to be there for a long time, we can't take storage tanks full of flammable oxygen on spacecraft that easily either, at least not a ton of it. So it's important to have a source when you get there. I remember reading an article about how that water that we find in the regolith could be broken down into its base parts. So you get hydrogen as a byproduct, and then maybe you could have breathable oxygen distilled from that. Very costly. But is it out of the realm of possibility? Humans have been determined before to go places. We have bases in Antarctica. Never say never is what I'd say. Let's see what other... We got a few more questions. really appreciate your feedback on this. It's really been a joy to do so far. Are there any apps that can help me learn more about the stars? Annie asked, yeah, the Stellarium is a wonderful program on PC. It can be a little intensive sometimes, and it's a little, it's not super glitchy, but I know on our computer, sometimes it's temperamental.
There's a number of free phone apps that you can download as well that will help you navigate the night sky at night. And you can actually do a live feed from your phone camera and it'll show what you're pointing at. The one that I have downloaded on my phone, I can find it. It's called Star Walk 2. I think mine was like $1, but it shows all of the stars in the sky. It'll zoom in on stuff and show a different kind of layout than we're looking at, and it'll just help you navigate the night sky if you're outside stargazing. I would highly recommend downloading something like that if you're not familiar with the night sky, and I mean I still use it all the time, and I'm much more familiar than I used to be. By no means am I the expert star navigator, but I can make my way around the sky, and I still use it.
Definitely.
It's an invaluable resource, and most of them are free.
Unfortunately, I don't think we'll be able to pick it up. We got a nice halo around the room tonight, which is cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Stellarium and other apps. The only thing I would say as kind of a disclaimer, as a warning, is when you're looking at the night sky, make sure you're not looking at your bright white phone immediately before you expect to see, especially faint objects. It takes your eyes quite a bit of time to adjust to the dark. And I get people who are looking at their phones through apps during a program. It's like, no, wait, just let your eyes adjust. I'll try to remember some things to point out interesting objects to the night, because I don't want you to not be able to see a shooting star or Polaris or some of these other stars that are just a little bit too faint if you mess up the rods in your eyes with white light. We did have one question someone asked. I don't have any specific books on the Moon Sierra. I have a bunch of books about astronomy in general that have good information about the moon. What I will recommend for reading, NASA's an incredible resource. Someone asked here on still photographs as well. We don't have any still photographs from tonight. I'm sorry, we're just capturing this on video. And these are not going to be nearly as detailed as some like professionally done photographs. I'm not a photographer. Will's not much of a photographer either. We're happy we got this to work. But when it comes to like stills of photos of really any planet, moon outside of, you know, our moon or our moon itself, I really recommend NASA for photographs as well as information. There are some seriously in-depth profiles on the NASA website. The Lunar Planetary Institute's also a good source. We've used that extensively before for programming. It's got some good information. And then when it comes to just viewing, I highly recommend timeanddate.com, stardate.com. They both give you moon phase information, sunrise, sunset information, like constellation information for what's actually going to be out at certain times of year. Or should you make a 3-hour drive to try to see a meteor shower and make sure you're not going on a full moon when you probably won't be able to see it. Stuff like that. That's really good about getting prepared for stargazing. So what makes a halo around the moon? Well, do you know the answer to that? I'm assuming it's just the light clouds we have, because we have a bunch of thin cirrus clouds right now. And depending on where you are in the country or in the world, it is making a nice halo around.
At least here.
At least here at Copper Breaks. I think it's just the clouds as well. But it creates I don't know how far you'd describe, but it's pretty large. It's very beautiful. So good question. I'm sorry I don't have a more specific answer. What type of telescope camera you would suggest? Well, our current rig, I don't have any real suggestions. I can tell you what we've got. We've got our Meade LX90 reflective telescope. Ours is the 10 or 12 inch.
Is it 12 and a half?
We've got the 12 and a half inch mirror.
That's going to be a bit much for somebody first starting out.
An expensive scope.
That's an expensive scope. And I honestly recommend a good pair of binoculars if you're first starting to try to learn your way around the night sky. Telescopes can be difficult to sight in if you don't have a good spotting scope set up and you're not calibrated correctly, it's like trying to look at a really far distant object through a straw. Whereas with a good pair of binoculars, you can put them up to your face and take them down and put them up and take them down and kind of get acquainted with the sky. And that's honestly one of the best things you could have for just personal backyard stargazing if you're brand new. If you really want to jump in with a telescope, I mean, that's this one, as he mentioned, is a Mead LX90. It's a really good scope. I mean, we are a couple of really, really amateurs playing with a really nice piece of equipment right here. It's
you can see in the lower left-hand corner, Carolyn asked about the telescope camera. Mead LPI GC Advanced, that's the name of the camera itself. It fits into where the eyepiece for the scope goes. It's specifically meant for Mead instruments. So if you already have a scope, I recommend looking for one that fits your telescope. I know they make adapters for phones to go on spotting scopes and certain telescopes. I don't know how well those photograph at night. I know a lot of phones have long exposure photography now. Look into it. There are options out there. Night sky photography is very cool. That's how you get those really, really intense pictures of the Milky Way. We get a lot of them out here visiting our park, and I always like talking to them because I don't know much about photography, let alone astrophotography. I'm glad you all got to hear the coyote. That makes me happy. I like hearing them out here too. Repeat some of those apps if you could. So Stellarium, that's the big one that we use on the computer all the time. Starwalk 2 is what Will mentioned. I think it's called Starwalk 2 because we had the first Starwalk, right? I don't know if I can make that claim.
I think there's another app.
There's probably another app, but Starwalk 2, there's a whole host of free apps that let you look at the night sky. That's one that Will finds reliable. When it comes to websites, I just recommended a few that I like. Obviously, NASA for its photographs and its information on the different bodies in the solar system and the universe. But also timeanddate.com, super helpful for time and date. How do we know when the moon is going to be right above us like it is right now? Well, we use time and date to figure it out. I can't remember when it's going to rise every day. And if you want to do a moon program, you have to know when it's going to be up in the sky, which is why we scheduled it for when it is today. I also like stardate.com a lot, run by the McDonald Observatory. They have some really good information there about viewing the night sky in general. Ed asked a question, I've been able to determine the sequence of the crater creation, i.e. craters created about the same time or different time. Well, Ed, I don't know the exact answer to that, but what I can say is that, whatever's resurfaced, like the Mare, right, the Maria, obviously those are going to be newer craters because that's a newer surface than a lot of the landscape. Actually, aging it, I am not equipped to answer that, but what I can say is that most of the craters and most of the solar system happened earlier in the life of the solar system when there was a lot more flying around, a lot more meteors, a lot more dust and debris, a lot more collisions between planetary bodies, asteroids, etc. Starting to get windy. I don't know if it's picking up on the phone.
Shake the camera. Shake the telescope.
Oh, that's where I was making sure it wasn't on our mic, but yeah. And I think we got all the questions. At least I'm not seeing any more. Again, we really appreciate all of y'all hanging out with us tonight. It's been really fun. What we're going to do now that we've answered these questions, if you want to stick around, or it's too cloudy. Well, we were going to try to look at some other stuff, but it's going to be too cloudy and too windy tonight. So I'm going to say we're going to wrap it up. Glad you all liked it. Thank you, Cynthia. I think it's been cool as well. This is definitely something I would like to do again in the future. And we, again, really appreciate y'all joining. And we hope that you decide to marvel at the moon in your own spare time. As Will was saying earlier, you don't need a hugely expensive scope and a cheap pair of binoculars. It'll be better than you think just glancing at it in your backyard, even if you do live in a border level 9 suburb or someplace where it might not seem possible. We have an answer from Thomas. The halo indicates an upper air disturbance, i.e. ice crystals, often seen prior to a change in the weather. I'd say that's true. The wind is shifting. We had a bunch of cirrus clouds, and the halo's actually fading. Cirrus clouds are mostly composed of ice crystals way up there. So thank you, Thomas. That is a better answer than I have. I appreciate it a lot. Thank you for joining us.